We're going to look at two passages of Scripture this morning, and you notice that I put on the title, The Biblical Role of Oneness, Part 1, and I have four items, and you already looked at the clock, I know. We're going to do the first point of this and then be dismissed. I'm going to ask you to look with me in two passages of Scripture. The first is found in Genesis. We're going to look at Genesis chapter 2 and verse 24. Well, 23 and 24. It says this, "And Adam said, this is now bone of my bone and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman because she was taken out of man. Therefore, a man shall leave his father and mother and shall be joined together to his wife, and they shall become one flesh." One flesh. A uniqueness in marriage that God gives us something thoroughly, totally, wholly distinct. In Matthew, in chapter 19, it says this in verses 5 and 6. Matthew chapter 19, it says this. Well, let's go to verse 4. "And he answered and said to them, have you not read that he who made them at the beginning made them male and female? And said, for this reason a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and they two shall become one flesh. So then they are no longer two, but one flesh. Therefore, what God has joined together, let not man separate." This issue of oneness in marriage is an issue that we don't hear a lot about. And it's one of the areas that we're going to be looking at in the next couple weeks. So first of all, I want to begin with an illustration of oneness. So I brought a prop. I don't always have a lot of props, except when I'm giving a children's sermon. And you know how sometimes they go. The first thing I want to draw your attention to is God takes care of both same-sex marriage and gender identity in the passages of Scripture I've shared with you. Okay? Real simple. It's what the Bible teaches. God made them male and female. The government can choose all other sorts of genders there are, and people may self-identify with all sorts of things, but God tells you, this is what I did. Then he tells us that a marriage is between a man and a woman. Again, the government may tell us other things, but God's already made that statement. I'm not intending to be controversial, because there's no controversy. This is what he says. Period. Now, let's go on to this issue of oneness. Because when a man and a woman are joined together, they become one in marriage. And in that idea, I brought a rope. Now, in this rope, there are also times when you could look at a cable. This little rope that I have is entwined with three things, which means that this rope is three times stronger than that strand. It's a pretty strong rope, by the way. But oneness is how things are intertwined in a life. Now, there are all sorts of things about oneness. Sometimes it's relationship, sometimes it's friendship, sometimes it's passion, sometimes it's sex. Sometimes, throughout our lives, oneness changes. The things that cause us to be this are because these are wrapped up in our lives. This is biblical oneness. A husband and a wife, a man and a woman, who are joined together, braided together, knit together, to be stronger than they were individually. Now, a couple of things about this. First of all, in my experience as a pastor, I have watched people in marital counseling and through good hard work restore oneness. Restore oneness. In other words, put the ravels back together. Repair the rope. Here's what I've never seen. I've never seen any relationship, where oneness has been broken that it ever came back again. Never. I've never seen it. When a couple's oneness is broken, in every case I know of, the marriage was broken and did not revive and was not restored. And I have watched some marriages come back, some pretty amazing, distressful things. Adultery, criminal activities, jail, prison. I've watched marriages come back from things like that because the people were willing to rebuild and repair their oneness. But when it's broke, I've never seen it come back. Never. Somebody come back and, well, ours was broken. We put it back together. All right. I didn't see it, so I'm still safe. So oneness becomes something we don't talk a lot about in marriage. And yet it's the one thing, both in the Old Testament, at the very inception of what marriage is to be, and then Jesus in the New Testament reaffirms what marriage ought to be. And in both of them, it talks about oneness. Over the years in my premarital counseling, oneness is always an issue. And if there's a couple of you who may be anticipating going through premarital counseling with me, you're going to hear this again. Because oneness is essential. Oneness is what some people have called the glue that holds a marriage together. I choose to view it as the strands of our being, the strands of our person being put together, intertwined, wrapped together to make something solid that is unbreakable. I believe that about oneness. When we look at oneness as it applies to Scripture, oneness comes within marriage. We are not told that we become one or have oneness with anything else. Only in marriage. Now, we have connection, we have support, we have loyalty, but only in marriage does God ever talk about this issue of oneness. And God knows math as well as you do. When he says the two shall become one, so one plus one equals one. We know that can't be. But in God's economy, this issue of oneness, this issue of melding and melding our lives together, intertwined, becomes oneness. Oneness is not going to be the same for everyone. It will not be the same for you on your second anniversary as it will be on your 25th anniversary. Murder may have occurred between that time. I'm sorry. If there is anything more politically incorrect that I said today, it was just that. And what I want you to see as we progress into this series, talking about oneness, keep that illustration in mind. It's what we are as we are woven and framed together. And it is not the same for everybody. Some people, when they get married, it's on a basis of friendship. That's where it begins. For some people, it begins with passion. For some people, it begins with connectedness. I like being with you. I want to be with you forever and ever and every day. Oneness is something that occurs in a marriage that God says is good. We're going to talk about some of the strains of oneness in our time together. We're also going to talk about some of the things that will strengthen it. Those are the things I really like to talk about. How do you strengthen oneness? Because oneness is absolutely essential to marriage. You may have never given it a name. You may have never heard anybody call it anything. But it is the central thing to making marriages successful. And to some degree, as good as couples are at making, protecting, and repairing their oneness will be the telltale sign just of how strong their marriage is. God wants our marriages to be strong. And so a look at oneness, how it relates, is absolutely essential. I'm going to ask you to bow your heads and close your eyes with mine for a minute. Lord, we as your people stand in a day and age in which the idea and the concept, the image of marriage is challenged. Lord, it's not challenged in my heart or in my mind, because you have clearly told us what marriage is. And Lord, you tell us it's about oneness. So help us, Lord, explore. Help us, Lord, look at oneness. And I'll thank you together as we ask it in Jesus' name. And all the people said, Amen. Amen.